now we'll talk about management of hyperphosphatemia in chronic kidney disease. Normally, phosphate hemostasis occurs between three main sites or three main organs: bone, intestine, and kidney. And in the healthy adults, there is a normal renal phosphate excretion and the net phosphate balance. While in anuric patients undergoing dialysis, of course, with the loss of the renal function, there is positive phosphate balance around 200 milligrams per week that will deposit in the vasculature, causing vascular calcification. Of course, in addition to disordered mineral and bone disorders in CKD. As we know, hyperphosphatemia is one of the strong risk factors for cardiovascular mortality, as we see here. And the higher the phosphorus level, the higher the cardiovascular mortality. Phosphate is the main issue or a main inducer of mineral or disordered mineral metabolism in CKD, and it results in reduction or suppression of vitamin D synthesis, reduction of serum calcium, and increased in the parathyroid, either directly or indirectly through interplay with the other elements of CKD MBD. Hyperphosphatemia results in increased in FGF23 and the parathyroid hormone that will result in vascular calcification, oxidative damage, endothelial dysfunction, coronary artery calcification, myocardial fibrosis, decreased cardiac contractility, LVH, congestive heart failure, and the cardiac fibrosis that will end in the increased cardiovascular risk for mortality. The KDIGO guidelines recommend maintaining the phosphate level towards the normal range of 2.5 to 4.5. This is the last recommendation of the KDIGO guidelines. And these are the current strategies to lower serum phosphate, which is dialysis, dietary phosphate restriction, phosphate binders, and the controlling parathyroid hormone. And as we see, every strategy has its own drawbacks, and they should be implemented as we can in the same time. So the novel paradigm for hyperphosphatemia management is to utilize the 3 Ds, utilize the diet, control, adequate dialysis, and drug, and you can start by more than one drug. In contrast to the conventional approach, which starts with dietary intervention, and if it fails, you can use the phosphate binders and then vitamin D and then calcium mimetics. Regarding the novel paradigm, you can start with more than one medication in addition to dialysis and dietary restriction at the same time. And you should use the holistic approach. You should target the kidney by adequate dialysis. You should target the gut by dietary restriction of phosphate and using phosphate binders. And you should target the bone by using vitamin D and calcium mimetics. And also you should try to preserve the residual renal function in addition to other modalities to reach your target with normal or the target serum phosphate in CKD. Regarding the dietary phosphate control, foods high in phosphorus are plentiful in the normal diet, like meats, fish, nuts, whole grains, legumes, and cheese, and they contain many important nutrients. Thus, avoiding phosphorus-rich foods can be difficult for patients with CKD, and the malnutrition is an important concern in this already nutritionally compromised patient population. The highest concentration of natural occurring phosphate is found in the cereal grains, cheese, egg yolk, legumes, and fish and meat. You should take care of the bioavailability of phosphorus in the diet, which means the percent of phosphate absorption from the intestine. The plant-based phosphorus is associated with moderate bioavailability, like grains, legumes, and nuts, while animal food containing phosphorus like meat, cheese, and fish has higher bioavailability, so you should try to use plant-based protein. And of course, you should avoid completely inorganic additives like soda, prepared foods, and canned foods, which is approximately 100% bioavailability. You should also take care of the hidden source of phosphorus, like food additives, like the poor labeling of phosphate content in the food labels, and the phosphorus in medications. Some commonly used medications contain high concentration of phosphorus, and we don't know, like these drugs, like paroxetine, amlodipine, lisinopril, sitagliptin, and acetaminophen. So you should take care of the high phosphorus content in some medications and what we call the hidden phosphorus content. Nutritional education is very important regarding the nutritional control, and the patient should be encouraged to consume foods with the least amount of organic phosphate, low phosphate to protein ratio, and adequate protein intake. The care should be taken in maintenance dialysis patient to avoid concomitant reduction in the dietary protein restriction causing protein energy malnutrition, which is very bad and associated with high mortality. One of the good examples for phosphorus or education is the phosphate pyramid. Like we see, the base of the pyramid is favorable. It's associated with low phosphate content like egg white, butter, sugar, protein, free products, fruits and vegetables, olive oil and vegetable oils. And as we move upward, the content and the bioavailability of the phosphorus increase and should be avoided, and we should avoid the top of the pyramids, including beverage and the food with phosphate additives like soft drinks, dehydrated milk, processed cheese, meats, bagged desserts, and instant coffees. And it is my pleasure to share in this research with my colleagues and Professor Hussein Shayesha Rahmatullah Ali with the effect of nutritional education on the phosphorus control. And this paper will appear in the next issue of the Journal of Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation. We utilized the Egyptian phosphorus meal produced by our colleague, nutritional consultant, Dr. Dua Hamid Sabakhawi, and she divided in an Egyptian manner or in the Egyptian food in two categories, with the high concentration of phosphate that should be avoided and the low concentration of phosphate that can be used. We divided our patients into equal groups, the group which was subjected to nutritional education and the control group. And we found a significant reduction, about 13.8% reduction in serum phosphate, reduction in the percentage of hyperphosphatemia, and of course, calcium phosphorus product, without jeopardizing the anemia status or the nutritional status. And the nutritional counseling was associated with about 0.57 milligram per deciliter reduction in the serum phosphate. The second modality for hyperphosphatemia management is the dialytic removal of phosphorus. The standard hemodialysis, which is 4 hour session, removes on average 700 to 900 milligram of phosphorus, amounting to a weekly phosphorus removal of 2,100 to 2,700 milligram with a conventional thrice weekly hemodialysis regimen and a large phosphorus diet. Although the phosphorus is classified as a small molecule, it behaves like a middle molecule and is negatively charged, thus leading to reduced dialytic clearance compared with small water-soluble molecules. Serum phosphorus levels plateau during the latter part of the dialysis session, suggesting that extending weekly dialysis time or increasing the dialysis frequency to 5 to 6 times per week may represent an attractive alternative treatment schedules for the additional phosphorus control. And this observational study found that the standard daily or the daily hemodialysis was associated with more reduction in serum phosphate compared to the conventional dialysis. And this was confirmed with the larger trials, which daily frequent hemodialysis network, more reduction in the 6 times per week hemodialysis sessions, and also with the nocturnal frequent hemodialysis network, confirmed the same results. And this is the dialytic removal with the different modalities for hemodialysis. And the best phosphate removal was achieved with nocturnal daily hemodialysis, 6 sessions per week, and each session for 6 to 8 hours. This is the best modality for phosphorus content. And despite this, it remains that adequate dialytic removal of phosphate is unmet need. And more than 25% of dialysis patients still have serum phosphorus level above the target range. So dialysis alone is not completely or is not totally effective in management of hyperphosphatemia. Then we'll pass to the third item of the treatment of hyperphosphatemia, which is the drug. And these are the drugs acting on phosphorus control, which are phosphate binders, active vitamin D, and calcium mimetics. And they should take care with vitamin D compounds and the regular monitoring of phosphorus, as despite it is associated with reduction of PTH, it may be associated with increased phosphate absorption, and so we should monitor regularly the serum phosphate level. Calcium mimetics is also of the effective methods for control of serum phosphorus, and we will focus on the phosphate-lowering pharmacological agents acting on in the GIT. These are the pharmacological agents, either phosphate binders, which bind with phosphate to form non-absorbable complex that will be excreted in the stool, or to block the absorption of phosphate. We have two methods, either blocking the transferrin, active transferrin, by the nicotinamide and the nicotinic acid, by blocking the sodium phosphate transporter 2B, or blocking the paracellular transport through the sodium hydrogen exporter, through which is blocked by the tenapanol. Blocking this transporter leads to intracellular accumulation of proton hydrogen that lead to conformational change in the tight junction and the blocking of the paracellular phosphate transport. This is a timeline of phosphate binder development, starting with aluminum-based binders in the 1970s, passing through the calcium binders, magnesium binders, sevelamer, lanthanum, and lastly, the iron-based binders. Okay, and this is the pros and cons of each one of them. Each one of them has its own advantage and disadvantage. Despite this, there is limited binding capacity, and as we see here, the binding or phosphate binding capacity limit related to the daily phosphate intake is about to only 200 milligram per day. And this is the phosphate intake in patient with diet restriction, which is 1,400. So we still have limited 1,200 that should be removed by another method. And the problem is increased, of course, with patient with increased phosphate intake with the modern diet. So phosphate binders alone is not effective for control. And of course, in addition to this, the large pill burden, this is the pill burden for medications used during by the CKD patients. The largest burden was achieved by phosphate binders. I will mention some of the recent trials of the recently introduced phosphate binders, and I will start by the iron-containing phosphate binder, which is sacroferric oxyhydroxide. And this study was done in 530 patients, and the comparisons were made between the 91-day period before the drug initiation and then the four consecutive quarters. Whatever the baseline phosphate binder, either sevelamer, calcium acetate, or lanthanum carbonate, the use of sacroferric oxyhydroxide was achieved with increased in the percent of patients with normal phosphorus. There was no significant or even improvement in the parameters of CKD-MBD. Of course, improvement in the parameters of anemia and the iron indices, and marked reduction in the phosphate binders in through all quarters and all drugs. Another drug, as we see, is nicotinamide, which acts through the blocking of the transcellular absorption of phosphate through the sodium phosphate transporter 2B. And this study was a recent study, which is a combine using the lanthanum carbonate in addition to nicotinamide. These are the four groups: nicotinamide, lanthanum, nicotinamide, placebo, placebo, lanthanum, placebo, placebo. There was no significant change in compared using lanthanum or nicotinamide in comparison to the placebo. The adverse events was comparable, and the drug discontinuation was highest in the group using combination. So this study revealed that this combination did not improve the hyperphosphatemia much. Another drug, which is tenapanor, which is a non-binder, it is sodium hydrogen exchanger inhibitor. It leads to intracellular accumulation of hydrogen, leading to conformational change in the tight junction and the blocking the paracellular transport of phosphate absorption. It's approved for treatment for irritable bowel syndrome with constipation, and it has been studied as an inhibitor. And this is the recent study, which is Freedom study, that was divided into three periods: randomized treatment period, comparing or randomizing patient to tenapanor versus sevelamer, and then the randomized withdrawal period. The patient received the tenapanor, half of them completed, and half of them were shifted to placebo, and then the safety extension period. They found that using tenapanor was associated with reduction and the maintenance of serum phosphate level, and it was comparable to sevelamer hydrochloride. And in comparison to placebo, the patient using tenapanor, there was a more significant change in serum phosphate in patients using tenapanor, and of course the serum phosphate was lower in the patient using tenapanor. And the adverse events, which is even serious adverse events, were more prevalent in the patient using sevelamer. And this is the conclusion: the diarrhea was the most common side effect most frequently reported adverse events. The serious adverse events were reported more frequently for those treated with sevelamer versus tenapanor, and it was associated with versus placebo with reduction of 1.4 milligram per deciliter. And the conclusion was that tenapanor reduced serum phosphate concentration and maintained control of serum phosphate in patients receiving maintenance dialysis with an acceptable safety and tolerability profile. So at the end of the sector of phosphate binders, these are the summary of existing trials. It was associated with mild to modest effect in the phosphate lowering serum. And we can use more than one drug acting on the phosphate absorption. We can use the phosphate binders in addition to maybe paracellular busway inhibitor, and we should utilize more than one agent, and we can utilize more than one agent. Okay. And we should not, and we should take care of the high levels of side effect. So again, one modality is not effective in the control of hyperphosphatemia, and we should implement all the three modalities. We should implement the dialysis, and we should improve the dialytic removal of phosphate. We should maximize the utilization of nutritional education and nutritional counseling, and we should use the best or the achieve the best, you know, the best utilization of phosphate binders, and we can use more than one drug acting with different mechanisms. Finally, as a conclusion, strategies to manage hyperphosphatemia include dietary phosphate restriction, the dialytic removal of phosphate, and the use of phosphate binders. While awaiting the results of ongoing randomized control trials assessing the clinical utility of lowering serum phosphate level, it is reasonable to continue to target lower phosphate levels given the currently available data demonstrating an association between hyperphosphatemia and the morbidity and the mortality in patients with CKD. Patient education should include general recommendation on the role of dietary phosphate restrictions with emphasis on the hidden phosphate intake from phosphate additives in processed food and carbonated beverages. Nutrition composition tables can be used to recommend the food substitution that can considerably reduce the dietary intake of organic phosphate. Guidance should also be offered on preparing food at home using methods such as boiling, which may remove around 50% of phosphate content. Given the higher calcium concentration have been linked to increased non-fatal cardiovascular events and the mortality in patients with CKD, the dose of calcium phosphate, calcium-based phosphate binders should be restricted. The pill burden and GIT side effects such as abdominal bloating, diarrhea, and constipations are significant impediments in patients' adherence to phosphate binders. And lastly, the multidisciplinary teams who see these patients should specifically address these concerns and to consider shifting phosphate binders to maximize adherence. New phosphate binders may offer low pill burden and improved GIT tolerance. And thank you so much.